A very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you all to the session on preparing next generation law professionals organized by UPS. To the participants, a brief announcement, you can post your questions in your Q&A session and we will be looking at the end of the session. In the meanwhile, you can keep typing your questions. UPS is one of the prominent private universities in India, known for its vision to prepare next generation professionals in the areas of engineering, computer science, management, design, health sciences, modern media, and law. In fact, we are focusing on next generation law professionals, which is the new task. I, being the dean of the law school at UPS, feel proud to inform you, our participants, that we are one of the most technologically advanced laws and with a resolve to prepare next generation law professionals. Innovation in the law sector is not new. If I may refer to Clayton Christensen, there are three opportunities for innovation in learning. That is sustainable efficiency innovations and disruptive innovation. Due to present pandemic, we are witnessing all these three forms of innovation in their full bloom. The practice from the traditional law chambers has already taken different dimensions, opening up new opportunities for the young professionals. What is required out of these professionals is to prepare themselves for the disruption, efficiency, and sustenance. Today, we are joined in the webinar by many such youngsters who are looking forward to join legal profession to make their career law professionals. We feel privileged to have with me Mr. Tarun Nagya and Mr. Aditya Prakash Rao as panelists to discuss and sensitize our audience for making their career choices. Let me briefly introduce you to our eminent panelist. Tarun is a young journalist with his specialization in legal reporting. As an editor, Tarun curates and delivers a popular TV show on NewsX called Legally Speaking, where he has distinction of interviewing several distinguished legal professionals on his show. He also edits a section on Legally Speaking and Policy and Politics page in the Daily Guardian and Sunday Guardian newspaper. He's an innovator and has ideated number of programs like Parliamentary Awards, Vidhi Mandal Awards, etc. He has won the winner of Red Ink Award for Excellence in Journalism in April 2015. If I may use your tagline, Tarun, welcome to this show. Moving forward, we have Mr. Aditya Prakash Rao, is a partner with PLR Chambers, a law firm specializing in public policy and regulatory affairs. Aditya has also worked with Amarchand Mangaldas in the capacity of a principal associate designate at Public Policy and Regulatory Affairs Practice, as well as he has worked with IICA, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, where he has worked in different areas of policy and capacity building and regulatory interface facilitation. Mr. Rao routinely advises and assists startups and entrepreneurial ventures. He himself is a co-founder and has mentored many ventures. And is supporting not only this, also a lot of pro bono initiatives. So welcome, Aditya, to the session. So to begin with our webinar, I would request the panelists for their opening statements on the topic, preparing next generation law professionals. Let's first hear from Mr. Tarun Nangya. Tarun, your opening comments.
I would first like to thank Professor Vijay Kumar. To me, he is almost, we fondly call him Vijay sir. That is what all we refer him, and a lot of you students are going to refer him that way. So I would like to thank him for such a good introduction. But today I am in a dilemma myself, because having lost my job to the Dean of UPS, of primarily being a moderator and an interviewer, I have been in a sense a victim of the COVID-19 crisis, having lost my job. But I'll try to do my best in the new employment that I have got of trying to convey what I have learned interacting with promoters of law firms, partners, the leading arguing counsels of it on various matters, also Supreme Court judges that I have interviewed. The past 3 months I'll talk of, because they have been really interesting. In the past 3 months, what I have seen is that the judiciary has leapfrogged into the digital age. There was a certain reluctance that I used to find whenever I used to speak to judges and also lawyers about, you know, things like, you know, why are they not comfortable with, say, online hearings? Even judges were never comfortable. Suddenly yesterday, one of my regular guest on this show is Mr. Siddharth Luthra, the ex-Additional Solicitor General of India. He was driving to Missouri, and while driving on the highway, he appeared before the Supreme Court and argued his matter. Now, it's kind of inconceivable even 4 months ago that that could have been possible. But in India, things are changing. See, Indians, in that sense, as I have seen, we only reform when crisis hits. Till then, we are all very comfortable in our cocoons. So when COVID crisis hit, you had every kind of advocate, in a sense, also the whole judiciary, leapfrogging into the digital age. Filings are now purely happening online. People are filing from their office. What comfort? A lot of senior advocates who I speak to are appearing in the Bombay High Court, sitting in the comfort of their house library. But that also is something which is a big change. As far as the young professionals are concerned, I would actually like to thank Professor Vijay Kumar for organizing this, because it is a wonderful time for them to enter the profession of law. Why I'm saying so? Because, see, for many years, this profession didn't change. It was the same. Of course, law firms became bigger and bigger. You have the likes of Shardul Amarchand Mangaldas. You also have the likes of Khaitan and Company. You have the likes of Karanjawala and Company. They are some of the big law firms of India. But the mode in which they operated is suddenly changed. So it's suddenly suiting the skill sets of today's generation. People who are, say, the students are going to apply to universities for law degree, taking admission now, they are the ones whose first phone, probably what they saw was an iPhone, if I'm not wrong. In fact, I would like to cut short my brief comment here. I think Aditya Prakash Rao, who also runs his own law firm, he's much more qualified to speak on this, because he's a new law firm. He's launched on his own, which takes a lot of guts, I must say. Very few people are able to break out on their own and start their own firm. I think he will be able to throw light on how new firms are emerging and why it's right for you to join the profession. Sir, if I may...
Thank you, Tarun, for your insights. And indeed, agility is the key for next generation law professionals. And they have to find innovative ways to evolve, as you have found innovative way to evolve, change in your role from a moderator to a speaker. Thank you for taking that particular role. Now let us hear you, Aditya, on this, on your opening.
Sure, sir. Firstly, thank you for having me here, VK sir. It's always a pleasure to interact with you. And for those of you who have not had a chance to interact with Professor Singh, is the only thing that I will tell you is the one thing that really attracted me to collaborate with him on academic research, on points of inquiry, and even tossing over just general research, is that he is someone who does not let his inquisitiveness erode. I'll touch on that subsequently. Thank you, Tarun, for a very, very generous segue. For a brief background, I was at Amarchand Mangaldas, and then we started out with my then partner in 2013. And since then, our firm has been, by God's grace, given accolades on some of the work that we have done. To keep it short and to get straight to the incisive discussion, I would say a couple of the things that are static that will not change in this profession. And I think it's important for all law students, as well as law aspirants, to remember them, because these principles have, some of them even coming from mentors like Vijay Kumar sir, have stood the test of time for me, in which I would say has been a career of very interesting choices, to say the very least. One is Professor Madhav Menon's words, which is that law is a zealous mistress, that it's going to take all your time away. Yes. So for all of us out there, the world is also very distracting now. There is a whole host of choices in front of you. But that by itself should not constrain you. You should, in fact, be pursuing your passions in the electives and the subjects of focus that you pick up. The short point that I'm trying to make over here is that in the legal profession, Tarun did speak about the big firms, the mid-sized firms, niche firms like ourselves. Today, you have alternate legal service providers, firms which is essentially an aggregator or pool of talent of the best of all worlds, right? And you could perhaps be an oil and natural gas importer and you have a contract on the fly. You could today conceivably put together a team which is cross-jurisdictional, on the go, and responsive in perhaps what would have taken you 15 to 20 days in the heydays. That's the kind of. And I think what's important in this atmosphere where you have so many subjects available to you, where you have so many cross specializations that may be made available to you and so many distractions, is that you need to be very, very inclined and pure to the passion for the subject or the interest area that you're pursuing. That for me is one constant. The second constant for me, which will never change, no matter how tech adapts, is what is ingrained in the etymology of the word professional. When you're a lawyer, or you're a legal professional, the way you conduct yourself, both within the corridors of your office and outside, is extremely important for you to be held in good stead and account in the long run. That's the second static. Coming to the future of law firms, I think it's a very, very exciting space. It's, as I said, alternate legal service providers is just one element. You have technology disruptors. You have sectors that we have never thought of, that were never conceived of. To put things into perspective for you, there's also newer laws for all of you out there, which are actually going to have their own jurisprudence start from scratch. When we joined the profession, we had a Companies Act 1950s antiquity, and we had such a big disadvantage of not having that historical context. And then came in the 2013 Act. Sure enough, incorporating a lot of the older provisions as well, or improved versions of the older provisions, but it in some senses also reset the jurisprudence as it may, or the field of play for lawyers as it may. And I think it's a very, very exciting time. Insolvency and bankruptcy, an issue very vehemently covered by Tarun in his large, something that's of interest to Dr. Singh as well, is another area which is again horizontal. And I think it's a very, very enthusing time for lawyers, budding lawyers who are law students, and people who are inclined to pursue or opt for a career in law and are probably looking to get into law schools. I'll keep it short over here and hand it over back to our moderator.
Thank you, Aditya, for those opening comments, and I'm sure that actually speaks the experience which you had in your career and building up so far you have reached. I read a report by McKinsey Global Institute in 2013 on the 12 disruptive technologies that will transform life, business, and global economy. And if I look at some of the technologies that were talked about in that report, were mobile internet, automation of knowledge work, internet of things, cloud services, and likes. No one would have imagined at that point in time that these particular situation will come, wherein these technologies would become the lifeline. Aditya, what do you think? What are the benefits of emerging out of this new lifeline? Online learning, and will we continue to be on the so-called cloud when situation eases out?
The reality is that most of us were on the cloud and we did not even know about it. That's for your emails, that's for all your video conferences, that's for your WhatsApp chats, your games that you could have engaged in on your computer or mobile. These disruptive technologies, as you would put out in the McKinsey report, which are truly disruptive, have actually opened up horizontally across sectors, opportunities and avenues that were never thought of before. And I think in that sense, it's going to lead to a lot of opportunities for business and commerce, and likewise for lawyers. And with it comes a whole host of challenges. If I was to take this away from just the business side of things and bring it closer home, which is technologies to be used by lawyers, something that Tarun mentioned, right? Which is suddenly all of us as lawyers, as court, have now been constrained to start using technology much, much more. And our world is changing. If you were to look at some of the interesting projects, artificial intelligence, which is a much thrown around word and very loosely, machine learning, which is one step before artificial intelligence, is actually now in formative stages of changing how your legislation will be drafted. So for some of these attendees for the webinar today, I'm fairly hopeful that in the next half a decade, the kind of legislations and the regulatory frameworks that they will be looking at will themselves have changed. So I think, sir, this is not a new normal vis-a-vis COVID. It's a question of having to adapt slightly much more faster than you would have normally done so. And to the specific example which Tarun gave for the appearance before the courts, my personal opinion, without any disrespect to anybody in the fraternity, is that it is also a levelizer. It has shown us how technology can be a very good levelizer. There is no dearth of talent in this country. However, the reality is that the face time before the court in some instances, obviously looking at the volume and the huge roster and the complication of matters that the courts before in our country have before them, a junior lawyer may or may not get the best chance to be able to be heard and present his or her matter. But today, I have my allocated 3 or 5 minutes to be able to present my matter in the video conference world. It also allows me to be able to, as Tarun was referring to a senior counsel and a very respected one at that, a formidable one at that, who was, you know, who was moving from Missouri to Missouri and taking on a hearing. Similarly, it's opened avenues for lawyers at a junior level to appear before forums which were earlier prohibited because it required for a client to pay your fees to be able to make you travel from point X to point Y and then actually appear. Now clients can start looking for talent. So technology is going to be a levelizer in our field. There are other aspects of how technology adoption is going to impact our sector, but I think we can get into more those details much later. For online learning, I have always been a firm believer of the fact that the learning process does not need to be contact beyond a necessary measure. The pedagogy, the modules, the way institutions such as UPES have any which ways transformed and digitized all their content. The campus atmosphere, sure, is very, very important. And then I think that's a very big debate which is yet to be settled. But the online learning is one of the best mechanisms for you to constantly update yourself. And I'd raise my hand to say Coursera and otherwise, I have constantly, whenever I have been able to find time on the go, tried to attend as many courses as I could. Because skilling in our sector cannot stop. The moment you start becoming antiquated with your knowledge and skills, that's the moment that your market is suddenly tanking. I'll stop here, sir.
Thank you, Aditya, for bringing up that particular upgradation of knowledge. And I'm happy to inform you all that we at UPS believe in constant upgradation of our students and have several initiatives in this particular regard, like masterclasses by industry professionals, focused edge sessions for career-ready students, support for internships and placements, and access to enhanced knowledge resources through Coursera, Harvard edX, and many other different platforms and collaborations which we offer to our students. And actually, this is something which is important. And that is how we also speak about, you know, continuing legal education. We say that learning never stops and it has to go forward. And it is said technology won't replace teachers, but teachers who use technology will probably replace who are not used. And I believe this applies to the profession as well. And Tarun, how do you look at this situation as to technology enabling the learning environment? And as we say at UPS, hashtag learning never stops.
So I would like to first share 3 anecdotes and also answer your question. technology, things have changed both ways. I will give you, so before, and since I happened to know you when you were with affiliated with the Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs, and of course, now I had the opportunity of visiting your campus. I was always in awe of people who did engineering, who had an engineering degree, and then they chose law. And they happened to be doing very, very well in areas like intellectual property, in areas involving IT law, because they have the domain knowledge. And since I was not acquainted with your institute when I came, and I think that time you had invited Justice Talwant Singh to the campus. You had MOOCs going on. And I realized that you have that course where people can do engineering and law parallelly. So technology, so I was attending a global webinar recently, and they said that the essential skill set of the children of future is has to be coding. They have to be coding by the time they are 8-10 years old. And I asked why. And he answered that because everything is going to become digital, coding is going to be the language of the future. God knows how will judiciary change, because today we can't even fathom in the ways that that is going to change. So if you see adoption of technology, it starts right from the learning. You cannot suddenly become technology savvy after passing out of law. When you're doing engineering and law, you already learn technology. And since you are, it's like technology embedded into you. You learn your Bachelor of Engineering, you earn your law degree. And when you come up, you can be change that the country needs. Because India, as such, we are slow to adapt. COVID is an exceptional time when this has happened. There are news of artificial intelligence courts for there is some human intervention there also, but AI courts are operational in some countries, in simple issues they are also in a sense delivered. Things are changing. Law as a service. Now when I say law as a service, judges have told me that Tarun, criminal cases are different, but in commercial disputes, what we are doing, we are like your Airtel or your Vodafone. We are your service providers. We have to be technologically efficient, because law is a service. You are the service provider. And lawyers, in a sense, are assisting you to get service. But there is an other facet also. Yesterday, I happened to be at some lawyer's office, and he received a call from somebody who was seeking a job. And these are tough times, I must say. And he first asked him, why do you say you need a job? So even I got interested when he said that somebody calls for a job, he will ask that I need a job. You know, what did he say? You will join me as an associate. You will join me as a senior associate or a partner. There is no employee in the legal profession. You are either associate or you are a partner. You are a self-employed person who's going to be self-employed for all his life. So you don't, you are not in a job where there is, you are employed. That is, or a factory worker. A lawyer is a self-employed professional. So be proud of who you are. In fact, in a sense, I felt good. So this is one more perk of this profession. You're self-employed. You set your own rules and you join as an associate. You don't join as a worker. So, and I think Aditya would concede there, but Aditya made a very good point about hard work. I would like to expand on that. I was interviewing Mukul Rohatgi, who had just stepped down from being the Attorney General of India. And we do a lot of serious questions. We also do a lot of light-hearted questions. So I asked him that, sir, you have a Bentley in which you move. You have earned your place and you have, you know, you have just limited the office, which is a dream of many lawyers. He said, Tarun, I must tell you one thing. You can see this office, this bungalow in, say, Sundar Nagar, all that paraphernalia around me. But I wouldn't like to tell you, even today, every morning, even on a Sunday, many times, I am in my office at 8:15 a.m. Every morning, 8:15 a.m. Because I have to appear in court at 10. I have to read my briefs. So don't think this is not like a job where I am a builder or I am in some company where the employees are running. My face, my time, I have to put in. So this is pure hard work. I think this is one thing that can never change in law. Hard work is something which goes through and through. And through my moderator, Mr. Professor Vijay Kumar, I would like to understand from my panelist what he, because he runs a law firm, he can give a lot of perspective on that issue as to how hard work never changes. You know, even though you are running something which you own, it's not like you can delegate it to someone. I think over to you, sir.
Rightly said, Tarun. Albert Einstein said, once you stop learning, you start dying. And I believe this is more so applicable to the legal profession nowadays with reference to the adaptability to technology by lawyers. And very well said, hard work is something which is very, very important. Without that, nothing moves. And we at UPS believe that hard work, not only by our faculty members and the team which is behind it, we believe in curriculum which enhances the knowledge of our students, keep them updated, keep them in the currency of the terms, and that helps them, you know, to establish themselves wherever they go. So Aditya, if I may ask you to provide your insight on how technology, workforce, demographics, and business pressures and global attitudes are changing the face of legal practice, and how a specialization course in law could benefit aspiring lawyers in these dynamic times.
Sure, sir. Thank you for that. And Tarun, I'll circle back to what you said, hopefully in one of the questions by the participants as well. As I was saying previously, I think the role of technology has to be looked on its impact on law from two perspectives. One is that technology is fundamentally changing the way businesses themselves operate, and therefore our clients of lawyers or law firms or legal professionals. And I think let's just talk about legal professionals as Tarun rightly distilled it down, but it's pretty much everybody building out their own reputation. that has changed a lot. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is there is a lot of data forensics analysis that has already been carried out by clients, and they expect you as a lawyer to actually have the right skill set. This also back to a point that Tarun was making, of having some additional skill set than just being a lawyer, to be able to transliterate and make sense of that data and analysis. That's first. Second, as far as lawyers are concerned, from a client perspective, we are now being pushed. You need to understand that the average age of CEOs of the next gen businesses, and I'm not referring just to startups, I'm referring to incumbents, huge companies where the next in command, the second or the third or the fourth respective antiquity of the organization, are actually coming in and taking over the reins of the company. They are bringing in a very, very fresh vision and perspective in the way that these companies need to be run. And you as lawyers of tomorrow, maybe in half a decade, if not earlier, would necessarily need to run shoulder to shoulder to them as an advisor. You can't only think of yourself as a siloed role of saying, hey, I have given you these four regulations that are applicable, and that's where it stops. Today, lawyers are increasingly being asked to provide solutions and not legal statements. My clients today are not interested in the startup world or in the policy world to look at a long verbose memo, note, hypothesis, caveat, and so on and so forth. They are looking at me as a lawyer to necessarily arrive at the right advice, which is binary in nature, along with whatever business assumptions that I'm making on their behalf. That's how it's externally changed the profession. Internally, for most of the law students that you have, again, to underscore the point of having at least, if not very basic, an intermediate level of understanding of technology, is that law and technology, much like production and technology, much like sales and technology, much like aviation and technology, we thought all of these professions were completely isolated from technology. You know, that time is gone. I think we have to really embrace this openly, and it's going to change the way these law firm structures are also put out. And I'm not referring to the gig economy, which is not exactly a term I agree with, or the alternative legal service model. What I'm referring to is now clients having the ability to software as a service tools access to carry out all the diligence and the baseline compliance check using softwares. and coming to you for pointed advice, coming to you for being able to look at what the analysis has not been able to throw out. And to handle that, you need to have a nuance in tech. You need to be able to have a business perspective and constantly keep upskilling yourself. It was not that this was not the case earlier. For us in policy and regulation, we've always been put on matters where either by private parties or by the government, more often than not, we're asked to push the envelope. You only look at policy when you're looking at the cusp of what is law and what's actual business practice and what's the next innovation. And our general tendency as regulators, as ordinary people, as judiciary, is to try and silo something which is new and disruptive into the existing fit, right? And we've often faced that challenge, and we've had to run shoulder to shoulder with understanding how triple DES technology works in encryption. We've had to run and sit with software engineers who've actually built the code to understand how node servers work. How does the internet framework work? And then be able to distill. I think the lawyers of the future will have to have basic legal tools in being able to look at legal tech, and Manupatra and SEC don't necessarily qualify as legal tech. That's one. Two, they will have to have horizontal skills. It will have to be cross-functional. And at some point in time, I dare say, lawyers will become more of generalists than specialists. I'll stop here, sir.
That's a great insight, Aditya, and thank you for that insight. And in fact, we at UPS believe interdisciplinary studies are very important, and that gaining horizontal skill is important, and that is being now worked at, and we have come up with an idea of about the legal field, but also the allied disciplines and different areas. And in fact, the students at UPS have advantage in a sense that they have an exposure to faculty members who are across in different schools, which we have, you name it, and we have it. So either it may be modern media, it may be business, it may be design, it may be computer science. So if somebody has to work together with a computer science student, we have that particular infrastructure in place, which helps. And I believe collaboration is the key in future, which it will work. And towards development, I believe as and not because they are not good enough, but because they can be even better, there is no limit to what we can achieve. And I believe this is the time we have to think about this dimension. Tarun, you have had interactions with the doyens in the legal field in your interviews and through the opinion pieces in your newspaper section. Would you like to share with young aspirants of law and our legal students a few major qualities you find in these professionals which has contributed in their success and which we as law schools should look at the law aspirants?
See, I think what is true for law is true for all other professions is that little extra and insight. Insight which comes from hard work, reading, and the ability to offer solutions in every area of your company. I'll give you a small example. Yesterday, I was talking to a general counsel of a company with a revenue of roughly around $5 billion in a year. Now that GC happens to be on the board of directors of the company. So I asked him that you are a general counsel and why are you on the board? He says that I am the promoter counsel on so many matters that he said that I better have you on the board because you are not just a lawyer. You help me run the company from the corporate affairs point, from the point of policy, from the point of proposals and tax breaks that we have to ask for the government. You are drafting it. You are helping the finance team. You are basically the brainchild behind running the company in so many aspects. So lawyers are going to the next CEO of so many companies. We saw in one of the airline companies that a lawyer became the CEO and stayed so for so many years. So that's the big change. As far as purely the profession of litigation is concerned, where a lot of people come on my interview, I see litigation going through a sea change than what it was before, as also Aditya pointed out some time back. But still some two qualities which will never change. I will have to first explain. See, until now, litigation was a very pace-driven medium. In India, we like large figures and demigods. And we had those 10, 15, 20 demigods in India whose appearances mattered a lot. But things are changing. That the number is going to increase greatly because we are going to move from an argument-led model to a document model. Because when I appear on a webinar for, say, about 5 minutes for my argument before the Supreme Court relies a lot on the filing, what I have filed. He will go through my documents. So we will become, in a sense, like a lot of courts outside India, where documentation becomes very important. And I will have a 3-page note with me in my hand when I appear before the judge, and I'll make my points, but he'll still rely on my submissions. So, but one thing will never go, my persuasiveness. As a person, if I am an arguing counsel for the client, and the ability to push, the push to get the order, because this is also a profession of a lot of psychology, a lot of non-verbals, how I appear, what is my tonality, how I am able to convince and see the court to see reason in my arguments. In the end, the court has to see the reason in what I am asking. That is why one lawyer better does better than the other. He is able to show reason and convince the court. As far as law firms are concerned, I think they are the most hardworking of the lot. The entire job of making briefs, here I'm just talking about litigation. But you have a lot of other things now. There's mergers and acquisitions. There is cross-border transactions that are happening. And in that sense, the requirement of specializations in those niches will never change. Even coming to litigation, as you would bear with me, there are lawyers who are good in practice areas, but you will identify a certain lawyer who does very well in, say, the PMLA cases. Because he, in a sense, has specialized in that medium. And though he can do a lot of cases, people will go to him for these cases primarily. In that sense, niche areas will always have specialization, and that will brand certain people. Branding is a very important aspect. What is brand? When I think of a law school, and if UPS comes to my mind, then UPS is a brand. Because whenever I think law and the best school in law, if UPS, that is what you have earned. If I think a law firm for a certain practice and Aditya's face comes to, say, my mind, then I think Aditya has earned it. So that, I think, lawyers, because there is a lot of clutter. India is a country of 1.3 billion people. There is a lot of clutter. You will have to stand out. There are some law firms that do exceedingly well in tax law. Why? Because they have performed in that area. And whenever you think tax law, you cannot not help not remembering their name. So, as Aditya said, I would agree with him that in a certain domain, lawyers will be generalists. They would also like to be generalists because it's good business. You don't have to refuse anything. But there will be a room for a lot of people who spend their entire lives working for certain law firms. And they need to be specialized because they know they're not going to venture out on their own, open on their own. They'll be working with someone and they'll be hired for their specialization. So, you know, the beauty of it is you decide what you want to become. Then you take those calls. I would like to know more from Aditya because he's got the experience of working in the biggest law firm as well as launching on his own. But that's after Dr. V.K. Singh also makes his intervention.
Yeah, thank you, Tarun. And in fact, I must tell you that you have touched a lot of important points which requires to be known by our new aspirants who want to join law. And definitely, you know, everything has its pros and cons and you have to weigh them. And thank you for those particular points which you mentioned, which law aspirant should look for, perseverance and, you know, eye to details. These are something which are very, very important. And Aditya, you have worked in diverse areas of practice and I have seen you working there. And one biggest quality which I noticed in you, which I probably have not shared with you, but now I'm sharing it, is that... you are perseverance and you have a lot of eye to details. And how do you think it is important for the law student to set their goal in the beginning of their career so that they can curate their resume and are ready for the next generation?
Thank you for that. I'll come to some of the things that Tarun also, I'll attempt to come to some of the things that Tarun raised. One is my biggest advice to you, following from my opening statement, which was that law is a zealous mistress that's going to take all your time away, is that irrespective of what specialization you take, I cannot stress on this enough. Having spent about 12 years now in the profession, that 1 year in this profession of sincere effort is like dog years. A lot of people will tell you.
Yes.
And the fact of the matter is that unless you pursue what you truly like, and that itself is a discovery process, you are going to see the glass ceiling or the foolishness of pursuing X, Y, Z, and Co. Which has all the figures stacked up. Very quickly. Opportunities in this sector are immense. And today, it is disaggregated across chamber practices, niche firms, in-house. So the role that was not conceived or thought of properly till the year, I would say even the early 2000s, I would go as far as that. And today, you have, as Tarun said, GCs who want to become CEOs of, right? So I think in that sense, the legal profession provides you a lot of things. So don't be afraid to, one, venture out and see what your true interests are, and then hone in on what you would want as a specialization or a super specialization. My point with respect to technology and generally is with respect to being completely equipped on the aids to technology that are available to you, and be on the lookout and be trained with respect. The third point I would make with respect to law students, in terms of ultimately we're all doing a course, getting enrolled to meaningfully contribute to the profession, right? And I think it's very you can have realignments. I will be guilty to that, of what you want to do, but be true to your course. What do I mean by that? I can only give my own example. I was very, very determined that I would want to do litigation. The ultimate metal of a lawyer. In some respects, when I went into litigation, I looked at the process, I interned at the right places. Out of the internships that I took in my career, over 80% of them were litigation oriented. But then came along this very new field of policy and legislative drafting. I had not been exposed to this. And suddenly I said, hey, this is something which, yes, it's new, yes, it's untested, but it really piques my interest. And
to become the best lawyer? Or does it come with the cases we handle or dealing with the experience? I can relate to this particular question very much because I did my law from a traditional university. Probably Aditya also did his law from traditional university. And now there are plenty of options and opportunities available. And I can understand a lot of people have this particular question that if you are not at the top law school, then whether you are doing justice to yourself. Quite a interesting question. So Aditya, would you like to take this? Yes.
Yes, sir. I think this is a very valid question and often repeated pain point or perception for law entrance aspirants. I would be lying if I would say that being in a national law school or a premier institution, like being in an IIT for an engineering equivalent is not great. But what you do need to sincerely understand is that in this profession, as I think the question is a little rhetorical in that sense. I think in this profession, your law school credentials will only take you as far. The levelizer that ends up happening. So if I were to put it in levels from a law firm perspective, and I've been a part of, for the lack of a better reference, product that has been peddled by hiring agencies, as well as someone who's been sitting on the other side and looked at resumes. I'll be honest with you, at a fresh law, at a fresher perspective, definitely there is a degree of difference depending on which law firm you're looking for. There are certain partners who may have a bit of intrinsic, not intended bias for their own institution, but that has changed. That's one, because a lot of the partners from non-mainstream national law universities are today sitting at equity positions, bringing in some of the big firms at general counsel roles, including senior counsel. So that's one. Now, for a fresher lawyer, perhaps you could see that newly qualified lawyer, as I would say, for a PQE3 or a PQE4. To be very candid with you, the skill set assessment is all that. I would not even be bothered, hand to heart, to even look at which law school you're coming from. As long as your ability to draft and your ability to convey your message is the, I think I've the law school levelizer beyond that. And after that, it's I don't think post PQE4 has been asked far too many times, except at alum meets or people prospecting for alum meets or alum connects, as to which law school do I belong.
Yeah. Thank you, Aditya, for that particular input. And in fact, I believe that is what it is. As I said, it all depends that what you do in the law school, wherever you are. In 5 years, that is more important than the law school, because it is important that you give and devote, because a name can take you to a particular level, but thereafter it is you who has to prove yourself. And that you prove by way of the knowledge you have acquired, the skills you have acquired, and the kind of attitude you carry with you. That is very important. There is one question which always comes in our sessions is about what is the status of representation of women in legal profession. And I'm very proud to state to our panel as well as the participants that at UPS we believe in gender diversity. And towards this end, we have rolled out several initiatives like Shakti and exclusive scholarship of 25% on tuition fees for all girls students. Tarun, what is your opinion about representation of women in legal profession and how that can be enhanced?
See, I have devoted about 5 television shows of mine on representation of women. We took up an issue when Madras High Court had 12 women judges about 2 years ago, which was the highest number in India. We took it up. In fact, today, one of the columnists who have written for my page, who's a partner in a leading law firm heading a practice, she's a woman. and her age is barely about 36, 37. With that kind of a success in such a young age, of course, it comes up with a lot of hard work. You can work from morning to about 10 in the night, continuously working. Women are excelling. They are showing that they can achieve positions increasingly in the legal profession because brain intelligence is not the preserve of a certain gender. It's regardless of gender. In the recent years, even in litigation practice, women are doing very earlier they were relegated I think as little as about 20 years ago women were relegated mainly to family law. In the past 10 years you've got great names in India who beat the Prevention of Money Laundering Act, criminal law, corporate, and of course women are also running like Zia Modi runs AZP, one of the biggest law firms in India. She's a woman and does it very well. I mean, she's a pioneer in the field. I think it's not a gender issue, it's an interest issue. Interest and devotion. Aditya put it very well. 1 year in law is like 10 years in some other profession. It takes a lot out of you. You have families, you have responsibilities, but then you have commitment to the profession. And he pointed it rightly in the early years. The first 5-7 years, you wouldn't know when the day started, when it ended. Probably you'll have to be in office from morning 7 to say midnight, come back again at 7 a.m. But don't forget, your senior also will be back in the morning at 10 a.m. and he'll be much older than you. He will also be working. So it's not that you are coming to office and he is at home. You will. So in a sense, woman issue is more of interest. Are they wanting to give so much? But then there is the other aspect also. What kind of law firm you join? A lot of people take it easy. They have a good job. They are a good, they are senior associate, principal associate, become partners. They are not that ambitious, but salaries are very good in law these days. So you can have a very cushy boxwala type job. You have your two cars, your house. And in fact, I would also like to answer the question which you earlier asked. I happened to be visiting the office and for a meeting with a lawyer who grew in Bhilai. At a village near Patna. His English is not good. Even today, his English is not good. But the whole of Delhi knows that IPC, CRPC, Evidence Act and law related to money laundering, he knows it by heart. So he is performing the best in court. His English is not good, mind you, and still, he still has got. But as I entered his office, I saw two cars whose cumulative value would be more than about 4 crore rupees. Hard-earned money. He works hard. He owns a whole building in one of the most poshest localities of Delhi. He doesn't come from a law college whose name you wouldn't remember. So that is why you have to work for a good law college will get you the top 3-4 law firms. But in the long run, I've seen people who succeed on their own are very exceptional people. A law graduate joins a small law firm. What a guy doesn't learn in a big law firm, the small law firm teaches him everything because of they're nimble. And they are small, they put the young lawyer to many areas. So he learns, his skill set grows. In big organization, your skill sets may not grow beyond a point because there is a dedicated staff for each job. So you would not want to learn that. So these kind of people have branched out on their own. I know many young guys, and frankly, I didn't tell you, guys as young as 30, 31, already running their own law firms, employing 10, 12 people. But that's a drive. That's not a man thing. Zia Modi couldn't be Zia Modi because she's a woman or a man. She's a person who's simply passionate about her work. I think passion will trump gender. Passion is what will dictate what we become. Of course, luck will always play a part. A lot of things that happen to us are luck, but it is passion plus luck. It cannot be just luck.
Yeah, Aditya, please.
Just one observation that I have is that increasingly, you have women coming in and participating in the legal fraternity. And if you follow markets all across the world, they have not only entered, they have entered, if I was to use, occupied and dethroned the other gender. And there is a reason for that. The reason for that, as put out by a lot of behavioral psychologists, is that women generally tend to have a higher EQ. And as Tarun put out in one of his initial comments, this profession is not just about IT, it's also about people. And therefore, their ability to multitask, to be able to manage matters and sense the apprehension or the situation vis-a-vis a particular interaction tends to be slightly higher. And in that sense, I would say I completely agree with what Tarun has put out. It's up to each individual and their day. But for those who believe that this profession is not meted out for them, I think I should put it out that there is an added advantage, which I'm not saying so. There's enough scientific journals trying to that fact that give them the leverage.
That's great. It was an insightful talk we had, Aditya and Tarun, and wonderful points given by you for law aspirants. I think that we are now closing towards our session. It is already 59. And I had one question, though, if we may not extend, maybe one liner if you can provide. As to what should one look for in a law school? How should one decide on which college to join to be successful in legal profession? Maybe one liner if you can provide.
Multidisciplinary, tech savvy, teachers who are not just academicians, but practitioners. And when I mean practitioners, I mean they are also researchers giving applied research.
Great. Tarun.
What I feel is these days is the day of something extra. Now, what is that little extra? When I do engineering with law, that's the cherry on top. You know, because when somebody wants to hire me and he wants to hand me over a brief, he would know that I already know the terms. I already know the areas because I have studied it. So there is no grooming required, no training required. And a lot of students increasingly have already their areas of interest set by the time they are 18, when they are ready to step into a law school. The industry connect, the kind of internships that the university is able to get you, where you get exposure to industry, a good campus, a good library, that never changes. The access to tools that the university gives you, the environment in which you study, a lot of people tend to ignore the environment, but the environment almost dictates your life. So in any university you step in, you get a certain vibe of the environment that will dictate your choice. Of course, there is a talk of a lot of people become big by going to lesser known colleges, but that is because of a certain compulsion, maybe a family compulsion, maybe a certain other compulsions we don't know about that they can't leave their city. But given a choice, the environment matters, the teachers matter, the kind of options that you want. If you're getting the kind of options that, you know, I have a multidisciplinary option, then that also matters. So I think in a nutshell, it is this.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Aditya and Tarun, for your interventions. It was wonderful speaking to you. And I'm sure our participants got benefited out of it. You spared time from your busy schedules, I know, and I owe a party to you for that. So we will have soon, once this particular pandemic ends, and we will try to have something together. I would like to end this particular show with a quote from Roy Bennett, and he says, there are 5 important things for living a successful and fulfilling life. Never stop dreaming, never stop believing, never give up, never stop trying, and never stop learning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.